Tonight I wanna see the bright lights over me. Show me something magical, something beautiful. Come and take me higher, set my world on fire tonight, tonight. Show me everything I want to know. You take me right around the world. I feel it tonight, got me feeling so right. Yes, I'm a good life.
This week on Top Billing, The Bold and the Beautiful's Texas Battle aims to change children's lives forever. Olympic distance swimmers Chad Ho and Matthew Meyer look to turn water into gold at Rio 2016. Australian superchefs Matt Moran and George Calombaris tell us how they first got cooking. Jordan Lee Garbutt's sonic bursts of color show us what sound looks like. South Africa's gold medal winning garden from the Chelsea Flower Show stars at the Spring Festival. Citizen photographers turn their camera phones on all that's worth celebrating about life in SA. And your presenter tonight, Jonathan Boynton-Lee, brings you our lineup from a modern Highveld home that features the kitchen of the year. With see-through sculpture, stunning bronze lighting, and western sun on the golf course setting, it's a masterclass in style.
Good evening, it's Top Billing night and welcome to the show. We head now to the Eastern Cape, where star of the Bold and the Beautiful Texas Battle tells us of a chance meeting with South African kids and how they brought something incredible into his life.
Since 2013, South Africa has been a second home to Texas, and we'd come to Kariha Private Game Reserve to find out what the connection is all about. Now 35, this son of America's Lone Star State has made an impact on millions of fans of the Bold and the Beautiful. He's also spreading the love in South Africa.
Texas, of all the places one would expect to meet an American actor in South Africa, the Eastern Cape came as quite a surprise.
I mean, why not? It's beautiful in nature. It's different from Cape Town. It's fortunate because right now Marcus Forrester, who is still on Bold to this day, so I don't want to confuse anyone, is in South Africa. He's in Cape Town working for Forrester Creations. So for all you lovely fans out there, Marcus hasn't gone anywhere. He's still around.
You're perhaps best known for your role, Marcus Forrester, on The Bold and Beautiful. And on the show, you were the first African-American to have an in-depth storyline. What was it like being on the show and playing that character?
You know, we never knew that. Like, going in, I remember Brad Bell, our executive and our head writer, he told me that he wanted to do something different. He wanted to bring a character to life, being African-American. And I said, okay. And he asked me, are you ready for the journey? I said, oh, absolutely, bring it. And we took levels, we took Bold to different heights. We also opened up the color barrier. It felt good being part of something that was challenging, but also delivering a message. So I'm happy and pleased.
We know you graduated from the University of Texas, majoring in kinesiology. What made you decide to pursue a career in acting?
You know, I never wanted to be an actor though. You know, I actually grew up and wanted to be, you know, a teacher. And I do part of my work while I'm here teaching for a school. And, you know, I went out for a basketball commercial. Well, I thought it was a basketball commercial, and it ended up being my first movie with Sam Jackson, Coach Carter. And then it just took off from there.
Texas, there's a lot more to you than being just an actor. I know you're very passionate about education and the youth.
I say out of the year, I'm here like 8 months. I go back to the States, obviously, to work out of the four. But I met these kids in 2013. I was in Camps Bay shooting another TV show called Safe. And I met these kids playing the drum. I never heard anything like that. And I asked their miss at that time, what's this drum? What's going on? And she said they were raising money for techies. What is techies? I don't know what that is. I'm from the States. I know shoes. But then they said, oh, no, it's techies. I said, oh, okay. So then we went that day. I said, no, let's just go. We went to Canal Walk and then bought them techies. And then from there, I went to the township of Langa, and I just fell in love with the kids, and then I wanted to make a difference and give these children, you know, options. So I started my own foundation, the Texas Battle Foundation, Children of South Africa. It's great to be a part of something where you're changing kids' lives, and I'm trying to do as much as we possibly can with what we have.
From the age of 7, Texas was raised by his mother, Wanda. His uncle was a positive role model. And that's what he's become to these youngsters.
Sia, you must have got really good grades to be here. Have you always had good marks?
I may say that my marks change great after all this because here at PYDs, we are given time and we have tutors that could help us in some subjects that we're struggling from.
It sounds like you guys really have learned a lot. And Lisa, it looks like you have a very close relationship with Texas.
I learned that he takes care of us. He's like your father to us. If something happened to you, he will make something that will not make you to feel sad or something. I learned much from him.
And what role does Texas play in the lives of these children?
He's working hard for this organization, for these kids, and also for us. Because if a child have a problem, he's going to do that more than a parent. He's more than a parent. The help that he have is more than a parent.
Inspired by their celebrity guest and his support for these children, Kariha Game Reserve hosted 26 of them to join him on safari on the banks of the Kariha and Bushman's rivers.
What have been some of your personal highlights since you started the foundation?
When they do well in their terms, and I love to see their faces, like when we go to like a Rotunda Junction. The first time I took them, it was amazing to see them get on the rides. And at Rotunda Junction, they have this one ride where it's like a swing, and you put them in and they swing down. And I remember one of my kids, Aliva, and she was in the swing. And her face, she went up and they let the swing go. Her eyes got so big because she was so like, but that was my highlight. I like watching them. I like watching them do things that they haven't done.
Texas, I have to say, I'm so taken back by how hands-on you are with the children. What have you learned from them?
The number one thing I've learned was patience. When you're dealing with now 133 kids, it's a lot to take in. And then, you know, me being from the States, you know, it's a lot of things that we take for granted. So I think make sure you know that you appreciate the little things in life. The future's good. It's real good.
With enough love for every child in his foundation, he's a man with a big heart.
If you're going to have a childhood hero, then you need one with a great name. And they don't come any better than Texas Battle.
Coming up, the Proteas that stole the show in London. Plus, which photo best suggests the spirit of South Africa to you?
Spring is in the air and no one gets as excited about the end of winter as gardeners. With the recreation of the Kirstenbosch SA Gold award-winning entry from the Chelsea Flower Show, this year's Garden World Spring Festival is the happiest of happy places for anyone with green fingers.
Growing is what this season's all about. And with the most gardens ever on show here and a dozen landscapers exhibiting for the first time, the festival is flourishing. It's hosted by author and gardening expert, JJ van Rensburg.
JJ, what's the Spring Festival all about?
We've got 21 designer gardens to showcase to people what they can do in their own gardens. We've got the SA Kirstenbosch Chelsea exhibit back from London. So there's so much that people can see and do. We've got floral arrangements, we've got students' gardens, we've got kiddies' gardens. There's just so much. People must come and see it.
The event has been running for 22 years. What do you think has made it so successful?
It grows every year in popularity. You can't control everything in your life, but you can control what's happening in your garden, how to garden around your property, and how to make it special for you. And this is a place to see and to experience it on hand.
I know this is going to be very difficult, but with 21 gardens, which ones would you say are your favorites?
Easy Living, this garden behind me, one of my favorites, with a rumbling water feature, a sunken seated area, so you've got your active and your passive areas right next door to one another. But of course, we've got all the young designers bringing through all their beautiful, new and brilliant ideas.
Sonita Young has achieved a lush feel with water-wise plants and has taken her cue from the home of a famous Mexican artist.
Sonita, you've really created a beautiful Mexican siesta here.
Thank you very much, Lorna. Yes, the space can be used as a fiesta with your friends at the patio or a siesta for the soul where you can relax. Sit on the bench and just look at the beautiful, beautiful garden.
I think that's definitely one of the things I enjoy about this exhibition. The colors are so vibrant and alive.
Oh, absolutely. I love working on this project. Something completely different, working with bright colors, working with hardy tropicals.
selection of old clay pots used here. Just absolutely love this garden.
This garden really just takes me to a small village in Mexico.
Absolutely. My inspiration was Frida Kahlo. I can just imagine her sitting on the patio, relaxing, enjoying the space.
As well as Central American influences, there's this more African-style installation by Maureen Malaseng, a fourth year student already on her third exhibit here.
The theme this year is Leap into Spring. How did you translate it into this piece of work?
You know, in the first section, this side, we've got more the meadow style. It has the grassy feel. And then for us, in this side, it's just a mixture of perennials and annuals that are just colorful. And also on the walls, you've got the gray wall that showcases the winter, and then the blue wall that showcases the clear blue skies that's about to come.
You have some really beautiful plants here. How do they complement each other?
Okay, so on the meadow section, you've got your deities, you've got your Europes, you've got Santhericums. Those are your indigenous plants, so they would require less water, but they want to be planted in full sun. And on the other side, you've got most your exotic annuals, your pansies, your dianthus. They require more water, and they want to be placed also in full sun, as compared to the other plants that you would place in semi shade, like your clivias.
With every landscape design, you must have your favorite features.
My favorite would be the pathway. You've got your gravel in the pathway. You've got the water feature that is not splashy. So we've been very water wise.
I love that. Maureen, thank you so much. This is really stunning.
They are also proudly hosting a recreation of the South African exhibit from the Chelsea Flower Show in London. Designed by David Davidson and Raymond Hudson, it marks the 100th birthday of Kirstenbosch Botanical Gardens.
Gentlemen, this is a design feat. What are some of the challenges of carrying something like this across the ocean to a show like the Chelsea Flower Show?
We take absolutely everything with us, from all the plant material to the construction material to the white beach sand, which you can't get in England. Then another challenge for us is that we create a naturalistic landscape display using just cut flower plant material. We're not allowed to actually export live plant material into the UK, whereas many of the gardens at the show are live gardens, so that's our other challenge. But fortunately, with this one in particular, using the fynbos, the proteas from the Cape Floral Kingdom, the flowers are very long-lasting, so that helps keep our exhibit looking fresh and alive.
How do you keep reinventing your landscape designs?
Well, we tend to draw on nature for our inspiration when it comes to design. To create such a wonderful display, we're very fortunate to be working with fynbos, and one has a look at nature and you can actually just try and sort of work that into the design.
You have 34 gold medals under your belt. What do you think it is that keeps people traveling from all around the world to come see your exhibition?
We have a fantastic biodiversity in the country and a huge range of species of plants. So we're able to show them not just a protea, but 50 or 60 different kinds of proteas. What was very gratifying for us this year was that we actually got recognition from the House of Parliament. They sent us a letter of congratulation to Kirstenbosch, congratulating the team for winning the gold medal at such a prestigious event and keeping the South African flag flying on an international platform, which we're very, very proud of.
Botswana's Priscilla Bunder changed careers from systems analyst to professional landscaper.
Priscilla, this is obviously my favorite garden.
Oh, thank you very much, Lorna. I did this garden specifically for top billing. And what inspired me was the theme, Leap into Spring. And spring for me means color. And I decided to go bold on the color blue. That accentuates the water feature. The color blue links to the round balls that takes your eyes all the way up to the sitting area with the blue skylight.
Priscilla has created this comfortable and secluded outdoor living room with a raised patio under a carefully planned gazebo.
Even though the weather's not on our side today, sitting here you still get a sense of harmonized tranquility.
Yes, because that was the idea right from the beginning, to create a tranquil, harmonized effect in the garden. As you sit here, you feel like there's more space because of the opening that takes your eyes all the way to the sky.
I think you've done a stellar job. Here's to the best of the good life as we leap into spring. Cheers.
Cheers.
If you're a gardening enthusiast, you have until Sunday, September the 4th, to catch this display of award-winning designer landscapes.
Hope springs eternal in a garden, as it does in an image captured at just the right moment. That's what inspired celebs and everyday citizens to enter their photographs into the brilliant idea that is the Mandela Day photo competition, One Day in Time.
Launched this May, the competition saw scores of uplifting images of life in South Africa posted on the website 67photos.co.za. The winners had their work published in a digital book on Mandela Day with a brilliant response.
Chris, you're the brainchild behind One Day in Time. What inspired this initiative?
Well, the positive energy of Mandela, naturally. I wanted everyone to focus on the positive. And the energy of Mandela is everything that is positive. So I thought, why not get everyone in this country to focus on the positive through their camera lens and upload on a website to show what a beautiful nation and country this is. And ultimately then publish a book.
What brings you out here tonight? You're such a positive influence in the country as well as young people. Why do you think that you needed to be here?
I think the importance about this event is showcasing the positivity that's happening in South Africa and not always looking at the negative that's always happening. So for Pierre to pull off such an event and for people to showcase the positive side of South Africa, that's always good, and it's always something that as Miss South Africa I'd love to support. And I'm so excited to see who's going to win.
Clive, what do you think it is about South African stories that make them so beautiful to capture?
You know, I think everyone has a different story to tell, and as one of the judges, of course, for More Madiba Magic, I'm looking for authenticity and something that encapsulates South Africa for you as a person, and I think it's so different for everyone, and it needs to be very homegrown. Even coming from myself, I mean, I can think of a lot of things, but the one thing that comes to my mind is a good old South African braai. Nothing better.
What sort of criteria are you looking for within the pictures that you saw tonight?
Well, what we're looking for in terms of judging criteria is inspiration, happiness, positivity, and all of the contenders showed that in some form. But we were looking for that X factor linked to it as well, something that was truly South African. And I picked what I thought was going to be the winner. I'm not quite sure whether that is the winning photo. We'll be finding out tonight.
Taking the bronze was Krishna Herbst with her pick, The Sign of Autumn.
Inspiration, joy, laughter, happiness is all depicted in this image. Very beautiful. What was it about it that spoke to you?
You know, some days we feel blue and down in the dumps, and I go to nature to find the beautiful things that's around us. And as it would happen, I found this picture in a estate, midstream estate in Centurion. And I just decided, let's take a picture of Cosmos, because that's the sign of winter that's coming, but it's still warm enough to have a lovely day outside.
Runner-up was Feiros Jaffa with Cape Town Splendor.
What a fantastic picture. How were you able to capture this moment?
Well, I was on a boat trip in Cape Town in December, and I took it from the boat, basically, off the waterfront.
Jazz pianist Antoinette Redeker won with Gogo.
Congratulations. They say a picture tells 1,000 words, but what exactly is it that you were wanting to say with this photo?
What I'm wanting to say with this picture is that what I love about photography, Chris, is that it makes you not just look at things, but it makes you really see. And I feel like there's people in our beautiful country that we can go past and we may not even notice them, but that there's an opportunity for us to really notice and see the unsung heroes all around us.
You guys are looking fantastic. Gentlemen, dapper, lady, beautiful. But what looked really great tonight as well were the pictures. Which one spoke to you?
I'm impressed with Gogo because everybody is doing this the Mandela way. Instead of taking selfies and, you know, being all selfie on the internet, people took pictures of other people, real people. And Gogo speaks to all of us. So there's a real message about doing things the Madiba way. And that's why that's also my favorite picture.
The winner's picture actually spoke to me. It was quite powerful, very strong and simple, got straight to the point, got the message of why we're here celebrating Nelson Mandela, capturing him in the best way that we all know him as. So I really liked her image quite a lot.
Lasa, the man who's usually in front of the camera, but what did you think about some of the pictures that you were able to see today?
Man, awesome. It's all about nation building, it's all about Mandela Day, and they were the embodiment of the betterment of this nation. Like, all the photos gave you a feeling, and that's what they're supposed to do. That's artistic, you know, artistic measure. It's like, do they move you? And these ones really did, and I really am so happy to have been a part of this process.
What image captures your South Africa? Post your own photo on our Facebook page, one that shows why you love to wake up in this country every day.
Up next, take paint, a beat, and a visionary artist, and you have the shape of sound. Plus, sculpture, decor lights, braille screens, and an award-winning kitchen. This house has it all.
fashion makes you feel good, is sound something you can see? Photographer Jordan Lee Garbutt's work stands at the bridge between the senses as he uses exploding paint to give form to the invisible wonder of sound.
As a photographer, Jordan's done stock libraries, lifestyle campaigns, catalogues, and even worked with the famed Annie Leibovitz for Vogue editorials.
Jordan, you're such a creative guy. Do you think growing up in a nomadic family brought out that artistic side of yours?
Yeah, it definitely did. I just got to experience so much more to life than just the city living. You know, I've lived in a place where there's been 5,000 people, and opposed to living in Joburg and Durban, it opens you up to new possibilities and a complete new way of thinking.
After you graduated top of your class, how did you work from the bottom to get to where you are now, and how important is it to get that foundation?
It changes the way you see the world and how you think, because I mean, from taking coffee all the way to assisting the world's best photographers, each step is a learning point and you learn how the industry works, what needs to be accomplished and how to achieve that. And it's something you can't learn in a classroom. No one can tell you that you have to get coffee for so many years or you have to do this for so many years, but it pays off at the back end because you understand every person's step, because without them, the whole shoot goes to shambles.
Jordan, your editorial work is magnificent. What drew you to this genre of photography?
Well, in my whole assisting career, I'd worked from food photography all the way to the top end fashion photographers in the world. And I learned all about how they construct their images and how the clothing affects the way that they see their work and how it affects people's emotions and who they are. So I wanted to replicate that in my own way and bring about what I feel and believe and put that into my fashion images so that people can relate to me and what I see in the clothing and what the clothing represents.
But capturing bursts of luminous color erupting from the surface of an acoustic speaker to create once-off images like this one is his signature work.
I was originally inspired by Martin Kilmus's sound sculptures, which gave popular music a visual representation. And as I explored this idea, the more aspects I found about it, and that birthed universal variability.
So from what I understand, in order to create this, you combine paint with manipulated sound frequencies.
Yes. In a nutshell, what you're seeing is a visual representation of sound. And how I created this was sound frequencies through a subwoofer, which in turn caused this paint to erupt into what we have here. But it's quite hard for people to understand, so let me actually show you how I created this.
The images feel organic and spontaneous, but require the meticulous planning of a physics experiment and precision technology.
Okay, so what you can see, I've got a very complicated setup going, but what I basically have is one key light from the side, a backlight, my camera's straight up in front, and what's going to happen now that we've got our exposure correct is that I'm going to activate the sound of my computer. That's going to go through the speaker, which makes the paint erupt. A sound trigger will capture that, set off the camera, which will set off the flash, and then it'll all come back to the computer in one big loop.
It sounds like quite a complicated process. How do you control the variables?
Well, the beauty of this project is that you could only control certain variables. So there were only technicalities I could do, but the rest was just up to the universe to decide.
The acrylic paint is arranged on a membrane stretched over the speaker. The camera is set to record an event just millimeters in size and momentary in time. Jordan then chooses the sound he wishes to play out in paint.
Okay, so do you want to see this go? Okay, 3, 2, 1.
Whoop! That's so quick.
Yes, it's literally faster than you can blink. And with this lens that I'm using, it's a very special macro lens, and it's basically like looking through a microscope. Because it's so small, it just brings life to this minuscule event.
Behind the high-tech, Jordan is an artist inspired by the ideas of John Lennon. To show you how he captures his still images, we needed to film on a specialist video camera.
In order to capture the high frame rate that Jordan requires, we basically had to utilize the abilities of an HD high frame rate camera, which captures images at 800 frames per second. The standard television has 25 frames per second to give you an idea. Essentially what it means is 25 still images all put into 1 second of video. And with a high speed camera, we've taken 800 of those still images and all put them into 1 second of video. 800 frames into 1 second will give us a much higher detail that we will not be able to see with the naked eye. And because our surface is so small, We had to utilize the abilities of the macro lens, which allows us to get in really close without having the camera in close while filming.
This is a demonstration of a law of physics that energy cannot be created or destroyed, only changed from one form to another.
So once you've captured that moment, you print it onto metal.
Correct, yes. The metal gave the images a completely new look, so to speak. And the beauty I love about it is that every angle that you view the image at, it looks something slightly different. Because of how the light reflects off the metal, it's slightly different. And those changes in perspective are similar to our perspective on an event. So that's why I chose to print it on the metal.
From thousands of captured images, Jordan chose 11 to make up his Power of Sound exhibition. It's a visual presentation celebrating life's individuality, and each piece is accompanied by a poetic narrative from writer Mo Libretto.
Mo, they say a picture's worth a thousand words, and you've managed to interpret each image with poetry.
When Jordan and I met and he showed me these images, I started to see the universe in these images, and our ideas kind of met each other and collaborated as we did.
And what is the story behind this artwork, Celebrations?
Celebration is a celebration. It's a celebration of everything that makes you you. It's the realization that you can't be anything else.
For a closer look, catch the Power of Sound exhibition on until the 12th of August at Jordan's studio called The Balcony in Woodstock, Cape Town.
So now we know what sound looks like. I wonder what color sounds like or feeling tastes like. Share your thoughts with us on Facebook or Twitter.
Just ahead, our Olympic marathon swimmers take the long road to gold, and Aussie superchefs Matt Moran and George Calombaris are in the house.
South Africa's swimmers have consistently brought us Olympic glory. Chad, Cameron, Roland and Rake are all household names. And in that proud tradition, Chad Ho and Matthew Meyer are raring to take to the water for this year's Rio Games.
Since open water swimming isn't yet a sponsored sport in SA, Chad Ho used crowdfunding to raise what he needed to compete. He rewarded his funders by promptly winning the 2015 World Aquatics Championships men's 5-kilometer open water swim.
Chad, there's a very interesting story as to how you got involved in open water swimming.
Yeah, so I started off like any other swimmer, in the pool, swimming up and down, following that black line. And then one afternoon, I actually had a bet with my coach and said, if I do this 5K on Saturday, can I miss training the next day? And he's like, yeah, sure, thinking it was a joke. So I did it and I was like, I really enjoyed it. And I was like, okay, cool, I'll see you next week. I don't have to train tomorrow. It's like, oh, okay. And then that's how it progressed. I just started doing more races, and from there, where I am today.
You're one of the best open water swimmers in the world, but what I'd like to know is, what are some of your most memorable achievements?
I've been fortunate enough to travel around the world and race internationally, and I would definitely say the two highlights are winning the World Champs medals. I got a bronze in 2009 at the World Champs in Rome, in the 5 kilometer. And then a few years later, I won the World Champs in Russia 2015. And those highlights will stay with me. And then obviously I've had to bring it back to local races. The mid-mile is up there, 7 times champion in a row. So these memories will always be with me.
You've been to the Olympics before, but how do you feel that that's gonna give you an edge at Rio 2016?
I went there when I was 18, I was still in my trick. And I just gave it my best. I set my own personal goal of coming in the top 10, and I came 9. So from there, I've gained a lot more experience on how to swim a 10 kilometer race and how the international field works. And I definitely feel the past 8 years since that race, I'll definitely use that experience and use it to my advantage.
It's quite fitting that you're training with Matthew. He's only 18 years old and is going to his first Olympics. Similar to you, what's it like training with him?
It's great to have a training partner like Matthew. We push each other every day. I don't know, I give him some gears when I meet him, I mean, because I'm a lot older than him, so he's supposed to be keeping up with me. It's a great rivalry and it's a great friendship, you know. I was on that path 8 years ago, and if I can pass some sort of knowledge and experience onto him, which may benefit him, and then it's job well done for me, you know. I only want to see the best out of him, and I'm sure he wants to see the best out of me, and we'll keep pushing each other until eventually one of us retires.
Chad's girlfriend, Cassandra Wright, sees him train 10 times a week in the pool. 3 times at gym, and she's seen the results.
What do you think Chad's chances are of bringing back gold at the Olympics?
Obviously, I'm going to say I want him to win gold, and I think he can definitely win gold, but it is anyone's race. It's hard to predict because there is no favorites in open water swimming. It is very much a fight until like the last K, and then you start seeing who's going to come out at the top. If you look at when Chad won his 5K gold, he was lying 16th before the last kilometer, and then he won that. So it's anyone's game on the day. Obviously, I am 100% behind Chad, and I do want Chad to get the gold or any medal, but I'm happy he's going either way.
For another perspective on his achievements, we asked Julian Taylor, who still breaks records in the Masters division.
What do you think Chad and Matt's chances are at the Rio 2016 Olympics?
Here in Durban at King's Park, you've got two of the strongest open water and 1500 meter swimmers in the world. So what I think is happening there is Chad is pulling Matthew along, and at the same time, Matthew's driving Chad in training. If you look at Chad Ho and his pedigree, he's got incredible resilience, and he knows how to dig deep for the big day. That win in Russia in the 5 kilometer was a sign of things to come for Chad Ho. So yeah, I get goosebumps when I think of Chad Ho in the open water and his potential and the opportunity that lies before him here in Rio. And Matthews, although he's 18 and it's young for a 1500 meter swimmer, it's a tough race. I think he's going to be up against it this year, but if he's able to break 15 minutes, which is a minute per 100, which is incredibly quick, if he's able to break 15 minutes, he's in with a chance.
That Matthew Meyer is headed for Rio whilst still at school astonishes some, but not his mother, Wendy, or his sister, Tracy Lee.
A family that eats together stays together, but how important is your family to you and what sort of support do you get from them?
I would not be where I am in anything, be it school, be it swimming, be it anything in life, how happy I am, it wouldn't be possible without my family. So I actually owe all I've done in this world to them.
Wow, that's really beautiful. You must be really proud of your son.
We're extremely proud of Matthew, Charles and I. So is Tracy Lee. We're very proud of Matthew. He's worked really hard. He deserves this. He's led a very disciplined life. It's not always easy. There's a lot of sacrifices to be made by the family. Holidays are limited, if not non-existent. And there's a commitment from the whole family. But our support for him is unwavering. There's just no negotiating. We're behind him all the way, always.
Swimming is a disciplined sport, but what other life lessons have you learned from it?
And it teaches you time management, dedication, all core values you need in your life. Also, I feel it teaches you a bit of loyalty. I mean, staying loyal to the sport. I mean, that's what it's all about. You got to carry on going to training every single day. Persistence is key. So yeah, just hard work pays off and nothing ever comes easy, nor does it come quickly. And I feel those are some core values swimming has taught me throughout my life.
What was the feeling like when you heard that you made the Olympic team?
Yeah, it's insane. It's with swimming, it's awesome because as soon as you touch the wall and you look up at the board, you see your time and you know whether or not you've qualified. So it was just, I mean, the feeling was instantaneous as soon as I touched the wall. And by the time I touched the wall, I also had a good feeling within myself that I'd made the time, and just looking up and making sure it was true was amazing for me. It was obviously a dream come true for me. I mean, that's every swimmer's goal, is to one day go to the Olympics.
Do you think Matt's chances of bringing home a medal are strong?
What we really want him to bring out of this is to feel the experience and to feel what it's like being there. And just for him to be a part of that Olympic team is going to be amazing. The experience that he's going to get is going to far outweigh any medal that he could hope for this time around. And I think in 4 years' time, that'll be different. In 4 years' time, he can go back with more ambition to medal. But for now, it's really to have the experience.
Tracy Lee, you used to go to school with your brother and you were a swimmer as well. But what's it like having an Olympian in the family?
We're all so proud of him, and I don't really get to see him that often during the week because he leaves early and he arrives home late from swimming, but when I do get to see him, it's wonderful to like hang out with him and everything. And just as proud as I am, my school's also so proud of him. They did like a whole torch ceremony for the Olympians, the former ones and the ones that are still at school now. So they lit a torch and now they're passing it to all the Crawfords in the country.
Where do you see yourself in 5 years' time, and what do you want to achieve?
In 4 years' time, I'm going to take the experiences I'm learning in my 18th year and in the years to come and put it all in one place and try and get the gold in Tokyo in 2020. But we'll see how things go, but that's the goal for now.
Well, good luck with that, but I'll tell you what the immediate goal is right now. We need to dig into this quiche. Let's destroy it.
and let us follow Chad and Matthew's races. Shout, scream, or support them on social media. They're determined to make us proud.
Those two will be on a strict diet of veg, protein, and low, low fat. For the rest of us, allowed a few cheat days in the month, next up we have renowned Australian chefs Matt Moran and George Calombaris to give us a few ideas on how to cheat in style.
Of the featured foodies at the Good Food and Wine Show, George Calombaris was a star attraction. A chef of Greek Cypriot heritage and father of two who's published 5 books, he'd far rather cook for his children than ever see them eat junk food.
George, where did your love affair with food begin?
I was never one to be sort of standing in the kitchen cooking with mum, but just loved the idea of how she would make us happy by putting something on a plate. And that's a really powerful thing, and I respect the fact that I do that now. You know, I can instantly be gratified by putting something on a plate and seeing then and there if the customer loves it or not.
And I mean, you have 7 restaurants in Australia, which is a huge feat. That is just phenomenal. And do you take that thought process with you when you are putting your menu together, making sure that you put a little bit of yourself into each of those dishes?
Have to, or I'm cheating the customer, you know. And I've got a purposely built development kitchen called Press Club Projects that I'm based in with my development chef, and we're constantly working on components, ideas, dishes that are going to get put into the restaurant. And those ideas will come from lots of, you know, things, either travel, my childhood memories, nostalgia. So suddenly this experience of coming here to South Africa is influencing my food, even though I'm in Australia cooking modern Greek food.
What would you say makes a fantastic dish?
It's not about how much money was spent on it. I think it's how much care's been put into it. And for me, the most incredible loaf of beautiful sourdough that's been made in an artisan way with care and love is everything. And the most delicious biltong made by someone who loves it is like, how does it get any better than that?
Biltong and bread. you're a man after my own heart.
I just think it's like the best snack. As I'm driving through Melbourne CBD with a grumbly stomach,
it's,
I think,
what
of
you
biltong.
Need.
You know, and I just wish it was in the side of my car and I could just be nibbling on it. I mean, no, it's the best snack.
No, you're completely right. Well, if that's the one thing you take away from South Africa, then I'm super glad.
I'm going to try and smuggle some back into Australia. You know, we've got the worst.
I've seen border seen your border control. So I don't think that's a good idea. You may get arrested.
I might.
Potentially.
I'll blame it on you.
No, please don't. I don't have enough money to come and bail you out.
George's fellow judge on Australia's most famous cooking show is fifth-generation farmer turned super chef Matt Moran.
What exactly is your involvement at this food festival, and what can people expect from a chef like yourself?
I like people to come to a show and I'm able to teach them something that they can actually then go home and actually replicate it. So it's not too tricky. It's all about really good quality food and letting it speak for itself.
When was it that you realized that being a chef was going to be your destiny?
I don't have one of those beautiful stories of my mother being an incredible cook and my grandmother. It wasn't like that. I would have done anything to leave school, and I had a little bit of an interest in cooking. And I started and I fell in love with it. I ended up working in a restaurant which was probably in the top 5 restaurants in the country, and I was only 15. Then I bought my first restaurant when I was 22. So I was very classically French trained in fine dining, and then I obviously still do fine dining, but now I have lots of restaurants which are more casual.
You've been in the industry for 30 years. How and where do you still find your inspiration?
I love what I do. I physically, every day I wake up and I think, what am I going to eat today? What am I going to cook? I'm inspired by everything. You know, I get inspired by going to restaurants, by reading books, by traveling. So many things inspire me these days. You know, I've spent 3 weeks in Italy. I went to a house in Siena that I hired with my family and friends, and I had a big barbecue, and I had some olive wood and some grape wood. I made charcoal every night, and I just cooked on it. To me, that is just, you know, the way of life. I love it.
What do you love most about cooking? Stand a chance of winning a copy of George's latest cookbook by telling us what you think on the Top Billing Facebook page.
To experience your slice of foodie heaven and get close up to the masters that reign supreme in this industry, be sure to visit the Good Food and Wine Show in Durban from the 28th to the 30th of October.
Next, a home worth waiting for. So good looking, so dashingly built, and so stylishly dressed, you could make it the lead in a movie.
Next up, we see what the cutting edge of designer living looks like. where art, architecture, form, and a sense of timelessness meet, we find this week's home.
While this Joburg house presents a contemporary face to the world, the strong lines are warmed by timber cladding, and it doesn't impose on its golf course surrounds.
Let me show you the Joburg countryside like you've never seen it before. Follow me.
The clean, crisp lines continue into the home, and designer Diebald Prinsloo and his business partner Leonard de Villiers readily accepted the challenge of creating soft, welcoming interiors.
Thank you, thank you.
You look good.
So do you.
We clearly got the memo.
Absolutely.
Anyone who walks into an entrance like this is going to feel very welcomed. One word, spectacular.
Isn't it fantastic? It's such a beautiful view, and you'd hardly know that you're in Johannesburg, and that's the beauty of this area.
Another welcoming piece is this artwork. I definitely recognize the artist.
It's a wonderful piece, Chris. It's by an artist called Rehard van der Meulen. It's called Eroded. And our client first saw it at another project that we did in Stellenbosch. And it works just really beautifully in the space because it doesn't actually obstruct the view. And it's just really magnificent.
With this visionary piece, less is more.
Of course, this is a family home, and I can imagine that the family spends a lot of time at the pool in summer.
They do, Chris, but this house just works so beautifully all through the year. It's a really easy living house. I mean, look at that fireplace for winter. And it's a really cozy, lovely, warm, inviting space.
Cozy indeed. I've been to so many homes, but these pieces here look very unique.
They are. They were all designed specifically for the client, so just about everything in this house is bespoke. 95% of the pieces were made in and around Cape Town. And yeah, it's just a really nice, locally made home.
With so much glass allowing the Highveld light to stream in, it has a free and open feeling, both inside and out.
This stays true to the country theme of the home.
Exactly, it's a lovely space, all indigenously planted, and a wonderful space just to come and sit and relax, read a book, and have a lovely, quiet time.
We can't ignore the double volume, almost a triple volume. Were there any challenges to it? It's remarkable.
This double volume space links the kitchen, dining room, living room area.
Voila!
Let there be light. We worked with two amazing artists in Cape Town who made this for us. It's all bespoke, handmade, out of brass and bronze. It was quite tricky. It had to be designed right down to the last millimeter. It had to be perfect. Of course, then came installation. So as you can see, it's very high. So you needed to have either very tall ladders or scaffolding. And try and imagine getting scaffolding into this beautiful home that had just been finished. The artists flew up and they installed it. And here it is today.
What's really cool is that the lounge, the dining area, is connected to everything in this living space, including the kitchen.
Yes, and isn't it a beautiful kitchen? It won a very big design award last year. It was Kitchen of the Year 2015. And like the rest of the home, it's beautifully designed by the architects. It's very strong, very linear. So we decided not to do too much to and not to interfere with it, but we just needed to soften it slightly. So we brought in a beautiful lamp and a couple of beautiful kitchen stools that are almost sculptural in design.
And everything seems to be concealed in a way. What's behind these doors?
We're
gonna give it a go. One, two, three.
One, two, three. There we go.
Every
kitchen needs one.
Yeah, every kitchen does need one. There we go. Leonard, my main man. With the sliding doors opened, this just creates a fantastic continuous space.
Yes, it's a wonderful way of just increasing your living area. And this is one of Leonard's favorite parts of the house.
Fantastic.
You're the man responsible for all the bespoke furniture and the designs. I mean, you two make a formidable team. Leonard, seeing that this is one of your favorite places in the home, what was the inspiration behind the design?
Chris, we were very much inspired by nature, by the view, by the amazing golf course. And as this is a west-facing space, the Joburg sun hits this in the late afternoon. And that inspired us to go for this amazing yellow color palette. Quite unusual for outdoor space, but we thought quite fun. We also had a lot of fun with these amazing turned lights by Porky Heffer. Not too serious and very playful. After all, this is an area where you're really going to relax and kick back.
It was Leonard and Dierwald's popular art and design gallery in Franschhoek which led to clients asking them to assist with the interior design of their homes, restaurants and hotels. They now install decor around the world.
Isn't this staircase amazing?
It really is. I love the way the curved glass shapes the stairs. And what I also noticed is that the textures of the floors has changed since we were downstairs to upstairs.
Yes, absolutely. Up here they've used dark stained oak that links all the bedrooms and upstairs all together.
The fact that the master bedroom is surrounded by glass gives it an effect that it's floating, and what a view to be able to wake up to.
It's wonderful. I wouldn't mind waking up to this every morning. Here we had to warm up the space. It was quite sort of neutral and hard. And we decided to go with a texture paint in a warm color, very neutral, to really bounce off the amazing velvets and the pattern that we've used on the bed. We've used very modern elements, all custom designed for the bedroom, with quite classical design elements in it as well. So you have a beautiful eclectic mix of furniture pieces.
The choice of art demands a closer look, but is restrained and uncluttered. It suits a home where the set pieces of interior design are themselves as interesting as art.
In here we had a challenge with the wardrobes not being equally spaced either side of the screen, so we chose the oval mirrors to kind of mask the fact that it's not completely symmetrical. We chose the beautiful vintage metal copper frame, just also to bring a warmer element into this area.
The sleek, clean lines of the bathroom contrast with organic and creative decor features.
I love this wooden pendant.
Isn't it wonderful? I think it lends a lot of interest to the otherwise very hard space, and it is actually bent wood veneer. So yeah, it just lends a beautiful sculptural element to the bathroom.
Is that an outside shower I noticed there?
Very decadent, and I think everyone should have one.
So now that you've given me a rundown as to what it took to create this beautiful space, I think it's time to meet the architects downstairs.
Let's do that.
The decor feels naturally integrated into the actual structure. Complementing the stained city environment is the strong, unfussy architecture of Atricia Jordan and Brian Charters.
Dierwald and Leonard told me they had a fantastic canvas to work on thanks to you two. What was the brief from the client and how did you make this happen?
Our client's brief was to have a very clean line contemporary home that was very easy living onto the golf course. So we took that brief and we layered the house from the street side down onto the golf course side and kind of unpacked it as we got to the side and made everything slide and open for this outdoor, indoor living experience.
Were there any challenges when designing this home in this Parkland residence?
Well, I think it was to get the structural design to be aesthetically pleasing as well, and just using different materials, softening the contemporary element of the building, just softening that to a livable space, bringing in timber, warmer floor finishes in the bedrooms, things like that.
The sunscreen is obviously a lovely architectural detail.
So one of the challenges we faced was that the whole house faces the golf course, which is west-facing, and we needed to block out that low western sun. So what we did is we created these beautiful sliding aluminium screens, which are extremely light and easy to slide. And what we did is we cut Braille letters into them, and all the words that we've cut in here are very meaningful to the client and to ourselves.
Chris, we used that same idea throughout the house of sliding open living areas. If we look, for example, at the master bedroom at the top, we've opened up the corner, so you've liberated that corner, making the master bedroom actually a big stoop, creating uninterrupted views, living out onto the golf course from your master bedroom.
It was actually a wonderful project for us. The client was amazing. The architecture and the interiors just work seamlessly together, and we're really proud of the outcome.
To build a structure on this grand scale and still have so welcoming a home is a job well done.
From this week's Home of Masculine Form, next Thursday and throughout August, we celebrate Women's Month and the woman defining modern day South Africa. Until then, good night everyone, and God bless.
Next week, Olympic sailors Roger Hudson and Asenati Jim put clear water between themselves and the competition. designer Leighton Clapton dares to go dark in this luxe apartment makeover. We go in search of the Gentleman's Flower Arranging Club, and globe-trotting yachtsman Michael Pamenta returns home to marry his Durban dream girl.